God, I just thank you so much for your goodness. I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for your generosity. I thank you for every life in this church. And I thank you that every life counts, that you have a plan for each and every single one of us, a plan to prosper us and not to harm us, a plan to give us a hope and a future. We commit, God, just the truth of Yada to you. And I thank you that in our own personal time, we would know what it is to Yada you in the same way that Yada and you sent confusion into the enemy's camp. You would do that in our lives. You would send confusion into the strategies of the enemy assigned against us. We pray, even as man spoke about being generous and having no needy among us, we pray in our church there would be no needy, that every single one of us would be sensitive to your Holy Spirit, that we would be generous and not tight-fisted, that we would be people that don't trust in our money or our wealth, but we'd put our trust in you, that like Amanda said, we would be people who focus on eternity and not this life. God, I commit this teaching to you, and I pray that I would minister with your power, with your authority, that our hearts would be open, soft, and pliable, and teachable to your word. And Holy Spirit, I ask you to come in and have your way. I pray for your spirit, your tangible presence. I pray for every life that we would be encouraged by your word. I just take authority over every strategy of the enemy assigned against us to steal, to kill, to destroy. And I just submit myself to you, God. I resist the devil and he must flee. And I thank you that you would speak to each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. So the title of my message today is this. It's called Faith That Attracts. And I'm going to read a story from Mark chapter 10, verse 46 to 52. But just to contextualize this, this story takes place when Jesus was walking from Jericho to Jerusalem, okay? It was the Passover season. The end was near. It was the last week of his life. And it was law that anyone who was 12 years old or older would go on pilgrimage to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. But for whatever reason, if they could not go, whatever the story was, that was custom that people would come and stand and line the streets and bid all the pilgrims Godspeed on their journey. And what would happen is people would walk along and they would walk towards Jerusalem, walk towards the old city to the Wailing Wall to worship and do what they had to do. And people would crowd around each other and they would sing and they would praise and they would worship. It was a real time of festivity as they were walking into Jerusalem. And if there was a distinguished rabbi, it would be even greater, like people would come and crowd around. So now there's people crowding the streets and Jesus is walking. And obviously Jesus has a reputation. Some believe, some don't believe. Those who don't believe still want to like check him out and see for themselves. So the pilgrims and those that can't go for whatever reason to worship at the Passover are standing on the streets and wishing Jesus. And while this is happening, the story takes place. So I'm reading from Mark chapter 10. And I'm reading from the Amplified, and it says this. Then they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a large crowd, a blind beggar, Bartimaeus, was sitting beside the road, as it was custom. When Bartimaeus heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout and say, Jesus, Son of David, the Messiah, have mercy on me. Many sternly rebuked him, telling him to keep still and be quiet. But he kept on shouting all the more, Son of David, Messiah, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and said, call him. So they called the blind man, telling him, take courage, get up. He is calling you. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Rabbi, my master, let me regain my sight. Jesus said to him, go. Your faith and your confident trust in my power has made you well. Immediately he regained his sight and began following Jesus on the road. You see, what we see here is Bartimaeus completely abandoning himself to worship Jesus because he was at that place where he was desperate for a miracle and no one else could give him what he needed except Jesus. And the title of my message is this, is Faith That Attracts. Faith that attracts. And I'm talking about you and I having faith that attracts the attention of Jesus. Think about it. So they are the pilgrims, they're on their journey to Jerusalem. There's many people there, many distinguished people, and this blind beggar, and we've all seen beggars on the side of the road. This is a beggar who's blind. He's desperate. His blindness had probably made him become a beggar. He's desperate for a miracle, and he starts shouting, Jesus, Son of God, Jesus, the Messiah, Jesus. He shouts loud and everyone tries to shut him up. And the more they try to shut him up, the religious scholars, the more he screams, Jesus, the Messiah, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and called him. So they called the blind man, saying to him, take courage, he is calling for you. So what happens is he throws his cloak aside. Okay, and remember, in biblical times, cloak was always symbolic of identity. And he jumps up, he throws his old identity on his side, and he says, I'm ready for my new identity. And he runs to Jesus. But what happens is, as Jesus says, your faith has healed you. Go, you heal. And he regains his sight. But you and I often need miracles, but we're not prepared to take the action of blind Bartimaeus. And I want to look at 3 points. But know that often we want our fleshly identity to shape us, and we limit our expectation of God to move. So there's 3 points I want to look at. Firstly, blind Bartimaeus was undignified in his worship. Secondly, there was a genuine humility, a genuine trusting that only God could do it. And thirdly, an incredible gratitude as he received his miracle. Throwing aside our identity is the best thing we can do. We need to have faith that attracts Jesus. So my first point is this, undignified worship. So he's walking along the road and he's shouting. He's shouting. Now imagine all the religion scholars there. I don't know if you've been to Israel, but there is such a sense of unity and song. I was there the 1 year in 2014, and it was Shavuot. It was the declaration of the word, the time of Pentecost. But obviously they are Jewish, so they hadn't believed in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So they were celebrating the law, because that was the original Pentecost. What had happened is Moses gave the law. And I was staying in a youth hostel on Jaffa Street, which is the street that goes directly to the old city where the Wailing Wall is. And I woke up at 4 a.m. to the singing. And I looked out my window, and there's all these Jews walking on the street, down the street, singing in Hebrew songs. It was the most spectacular thing I'd ever seen or heard. And they're walking down the street singing. So I went and joined them. And they're awed. So it felt like the whole nation of Israel was walking to the Wailing Wall, to the rabbi, and the rabbi giving the blessing and all the rest of it. But what really impressed me was how everyone was singing together. Everyone was walking on the streets. It was loud. It brings this picture alive to me because I can picture it. So they're all singing, and there's a festivity about it. But there's one crazy man who's saying, Jesus, Messiah, Jesus, Messiah, trying to get attention. So you got all these religious guys saying, like, you're breaking the flow. Shut up, you know. And yet there's something within him that doesn't care what the people think. He wants a touch from Jesus. You know, he's prepared to be undignified in his worship. And in 2 Samuel 6, verse 22, David comes back from bringing the Ark of the Covenant. Finally, the presence of God, the Ark of the Covenant, is with him. And he's dancing with all his might and his linen ephod, basically his undergarments. And his wife at the time looks down, and she kind of like begrudges him because he's being so undignified in his worship. The same as how the Pharisees were with blind Bartimaeus. And he turns around and he says, I will be even more undignified than this. I'll be humiliated in my own eyes. You see, the first point that attracts our faith, that attracts Jesus, is to be undignified in our worship. To not care about what others think, or not care about even what we think or our own reputations, but to say, God, worship is, like Tozer said, everything I am, responding to everything you are. You see, Bartimaeus got this. He was blind. He hadn't seen Jesus, but he heard and he believed and he responded. You see, what happens in worship is the minute we worship Jesus, we take our eyes off ourselves and our circumstance, and we put our eyes on Jesus and who he is. The moment we praise him, it says in Psalm 22 that he inhabits the praises of his people. So that means when you praise God, his presence comes down and inhabits the praises of his people. Now, the one thing I can't wait for is when we get back into a building is to have proper praise and worship. But nothing's stopping us on our own having praise and worship. And that's why we're doing these teachings of the different Hebrew words, so that we are equipped and empowered, so that when we come into his presence, we can be undignified and be like Tozer said, everything I am, responding to everything he is. We all have the capacity to believe. And we all have the capacity to worship. And it's funny, Jethro mentioned a sports game. I was watching some of the old Olympics last night, different swimming races, and that I love swimming. and I was watching it, and just everyone's response, even as Michael Phelps won his 23rd medal at the Olympics, and people responded in praise and adoration. Now, so much more are you and I created to praise Jesus for what he did on the cross. And what happens is, in our unity, in our praise, we're able to pierce the heavens. But there was something in blind Bartimaeus. He had heard of Jesus and he believed, and he was making a declaration. Despite it being unpopular, Jesus, Son of David, Messiah, have mercy on me. There was something within him that was prepared to be undignified in his worship. You see, for all of us, we can choose a position of being undignified in our worship, or we can choose a position of being dignified. But it's in that place of praising God, of letting go, that he inhabits the praises of his people. You know, there's 7 Hebrew words of praise. And I remember when I first got saved and at his church in Pinetown, the worship can be really crazy. And my mom came with me the one day to Possess the Land, was a course Fiona was doing. And she wasn't saved at the time. She's saved now. Thank you, Lord. And this guy was standing in front of us. And this is like 18 years ago. And we were worshiping. And God was when the pants, you know, when your underwear stuck out your pants, it was like the in thing for all the surfer boys in Durban. And this guy's jumping in front of us. And while he's jumping, his pants fall down in front of my mom. Now, my mom's not saved at church. And this guy's pants fall right down. But he does it in one motion. So his pants fall down. So he's now standing like in his drops, his pants have fallen down, but we're jumping. It was like Jump in the River, Jane loves that song. And the next moment he pulled his pants up and carried on. Well, my mom was finished. She was like, you guys are cooked, eh? You're cooked in the head. And from that moment, there was something in me. I used to say to Fiona, I used to say, I think we need to like teach people that the reason we go crazy, it's biblical, okay? It's not because we're a bunch of crazies who are high on something, it's biblical. And she used to say to me, well, that's just your teacher motivation. But now I run a church in London, so I can teach you the 7 Hebrew words of praise and say it's not just people high on something, but it's actually biblical. And that guy's pants falling down, he was having his David moment, and he carried on. He didn't apologize. He didn't turn around. He was a young guy. He was high on God, and he was loving it. And it really, it was hysterical, but it also did something in me of like, okay, such is life. We're here to worship God. So when you look at the 7 Hebrew words of praise, and obviously Jethro is going through them, I encourage you to study it on your own. There's so much online. But remember, Hillel is to be clamorously foolish. Yadah, like Jethro spoke about, is to lift up your hands. And when you do that, there's enemy. God is causing there to be confusion in the enemy's camp. Maldah is also to lift up your hands, but it's giving thanks in advance for what is to come. Shabak is to shout, to breath in a loud tone. Barak is to kneel down in that place of adoration, to bless God. The ma is when you worship God in a stringed instrument. That's what Jethro does on the violin and whatever. There's that place of worship. The hila comes from Hillel, but it means to sing and to dance and to swirl. You see, it's all biblical words. And it's God showing us, guys, when you worship me, it blesses my heart. When you're undignified in your worship, it attracts me. And blind Bartimaeus got it. He attracted Jesus and he got his miracle. So my first point, undignified worship. My second point was humility. You see, the second thing he did is he got rid of his cloak. And sure, it was a filthy beggar's cloak. Nothing special about it. But actually, all of us have like filthy beggar's cloak. Our earthly identity is nothing compared to our heavenly identity. And he gets rid of his cloak and he jumps up and goes to Jesus and he responds in humility. In 1 Peter 5, it says, clothe yourself with humility towards one another. God opposes the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. Blind Bartimaeus knew that he couldn't do the miracle. He couldn't get it from man. He couldn't make a plan. It was Jesus or nothing. And sometimes the best place we can be in our walk with God in that place of faith is, God, I can't make it happen. The government can't make it happen. Our friends and family can't make it happen. Unless you intervene, I am stuck. And those moments in your life where it's only God, only he gets the glory, it brings us to a place of complete humility. So what is humility? Humility is the opposite of pride. You see, pride is when we depend on ourselves. We rely on our own achievements, our own discernment, our own intelligence, our own skill, our own personality type. But humility is saying, God, I depend not on who I am, I don't depend on my personality. I don't just depend on my strengths, but I depend entirely upon you, God. You see, pride is unattractive. You know, we all know those people that are full of themselves. Maybe you've had moments in your life. I've definitely had moments where I've been full of myself and it's been prideful and it's unattractive. But humility attracts the attention of God, and it's actually attractive to those around us. But humility is a choice. We have to choose daily to rely on God for our lives. When we rely on our own strength, our own ability, our own intelligence, we get in the way of God being God. But humility is saying, God, I've got nothing but you. And you often see it how we respond to God with our finances. You know, genuine humility is, God, my money is your money. Here it is. But how do we know if we've got pride in our lives? The first thing is unbelief. Unbelief is a sign of pride because you're saying, I don't believe God at his word. I believe in my ability first. And unbelief is a sin. It says in Hebrews that unbelief, that God, we have to forget the scripture, but we'll get it just now. Unbelief is a sin. Secondly, when we're self-centered, it shows pride in our life because it's all about me. But actually, genuine humility knows that it's all about him. I'm just the conduit. God just works through me. Thirdly, when we're critical of others, when it's so, in the message, it says, don't judge someone else's weakness from your position of strength. We all have positions of strength and weaknesses, and it's easy to judge others from our position of strength, others' weaknesses. But the reality is that that's taken from don't look at someone else's speck in the eye for the log in your eye. That's what pride is. Pride looks down on people. It's critical. It's self-centered. Unforgiveness. You know, when we've got unforgiveness in our heart, we want our pound of flesh. But Jesus forgave us. And we've got to choose to forgive others. Even when it's so, so hard, we've got to choose it. And when we choose unforgiveness, we're choosing pride. When we're highly competitive, we have to win all the time. It's pride. All these things show pride and perfection. There's an unrealistic expectation of perfection. Maybe not you, but your kids. You want your kids or the next generation or what you're putting your hands to. And yet God allows our lives to be messy so that we completely and utterly reliant on him. You see, humility attracts God. Undignified worship attracts God. You see Bartimaeus throwing off his cloak, throwing off his old identity, throwing off trusting in his ability. And really our identity is like a filthy beggar's robe. And thirdly, we see him get his miracle and respond in gratitude. As soon as he was healed, he started following Jesus. And this showed gratitude to what Jesus had done for him. You know, Jesus notices when people were ungrateful. We see the story in Luke 17. He was on his way to Jerusalem. Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. And as he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go. Show yourself to the priests." And as they went, they were all cleansed. So all 10 lepers were cleansed of leprosy, which was huge because in Jewish time, if you had leprosy, you were isolated. And one of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. When Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 of you cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to praise God except the foreigner?" You see, giving thanks to God is a big deal. There's a pin going around on Pinterest that says, "Remember when you prayed for the things you have today." And Jethro and I were talking this morning how everything we've got right now in our lives, we prayed for about 2 years ago. Everything. And only God can get the glory. You see, the reality is Jesus has given us everything in the cross. He's given us everything in eternity. But we have to choose an attitude of gratitude. And Peter says, godliness with contentment is great gain. What is contentment? Contentment is choosing gratitude for what we have now. And unfortunately, media and social media has made it so difficult to be content because there's always someone that's prettier. There's someone that's got a nicer house, someone that's traveling the world more than you, someone who has got a, you know, everything on social media looks nicer and more beautiful and more stunning. But actually, God has given us everything we need. And if we choose an attitude of gratitude for everything we've got now, it makes way for more blessing. But when we choose ingratitude, which I think is our natural response, It makes way for bitterness, for unforgiveness, and unbelief in our heart. It's the only one return to give thanks. Are we the one who gives thanks for every little blessing, where he looks after the little things, or are we like the nine who forgets about giving thanks to God? See, gratitude is key to breaking the spirit of entitlement. How do you know? I know that I was someone who was naturally ungrateful. I was naturally ungrateful, naturally discontent. I had to choose contentment. I had to choose gratitude. I've had to stir it up. But as I've stirred it up, as I've got into the habit of thanking God daily, it's definitely changed something. We have to be people who know what it is to be grateful to God, who know what it is to give our everything to him. But when we do that, it's faith and it's attractive to God. Okay, often in our disappointments of God, we lose our heart of gratitude. We get disappointed when prayers don't get answered the way we want them, or life doesn't turn out the way we planned. But the minute we become ungrateful, we make room for offense and bitterness in our lives. And we have to be people that are grateful. When you go to a lot of effort to buy someone a gift, and I know, like, I love buying gifts for people. But what's important to me, if I buy someone a gift, is I want to thank you. And I know there's been moments in the past, especially when I think about my broke days, and I would hustle to buy a gift for someone, and I'd put a lot of effort in, and then there wouldn't even be the thank you SMS. I don't need a thank you note, but the thank you, so grateful for the gift, thank you so much. And you think, I put a lot of effort into getting you that gift, and there's no thank you. You know, like, it used to really grind me. And Jeff would go, why do you need a thank you? I'm like, well, I bought them a gift. It's manners. You buy someone a gift, they must say thank you. Just an SMS to say thank you. And I remember my early days, at one stage, I went to like 17 weddings in a year, which was 17 kitchen teas and 17 pamper parties. And so it was a whole lot of money that you got to think. And some of them were so ungrateful for a gift that was a real sacrifice for you. But it taught me that often God's giving us little blessings and we aren't grateful. We lose sight of the fact that this is a blessing from God. Or in the future, when I got given gifts, it might be from someone with no money, and it might be something I don't really like, but it's a sacrifice for them. They went through a lot of effort to give that gift. And so there must be a response of thanks. You see, there's nothing more attractive than when you give a young child a gift and they say thank you. See, it's the same with God. There's nothing more attractive to him. Faith that attracts. When we're undignified in our worship, when we walk in humility, not putting trust in our own ability, when we respond in gratitude for the cross and what he did. So how do we get that faith that attracts? You know, it says that faith is believing in something. You know, we all believe in something. But faith comes from that Greek word pistis. It means to believe, to obey, to have a conviction. And faith is always in the present tense. So I can say to you that I once had faith for great things, but I don't have it now. But faith is like, what do I have now in God's ability to move? But it says, and this is the scripture I was looking for earlier, in Hebrews 11, verse 6, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Now, there's many times I didn't get my way and I'd throw big tantrums before God. And my tantrums didn't move God one iota. What moves God is my faith. Is my faith in his word and who he says he is. And so how do I get faith? Faith comes from hearing. Hearing comes from his word. As I'm in his word, as I read these stories of old, my faith is stirred to believe for the supernatural. And if you're in a situation in your life where only God can move, that's an amazing place to be. Because in a year's time, you can give testimony of how only God moved. You know, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead. And I want to encourage us as I bring this to a close. It says in the message, isn't it obvious that God talk without God acts is outrageous nonsense? Faith takes action. Bartimaeus was undignified in his worship. When you are undignified in your worship before God, there's something where God turns and he looks. Jesus turned and he looked. When you respond in humility saying, God, I put no trust in my own ability, Jesus looks. When you say thank you, when you get your miracle, because you will get your miracle, because that's the God we serve. Jesus notices. You see, whatever your Red Sea is, lift up your rod. Make your point of faith. Make your declaration of faith. You might have to walk around your Jericho 7 times. You might have to dip in your Jordan River. You might have to lift up your rod. You might have to fill the water jars and trust for wine. I don't know what you're trusting for, but you have to take your step. But do it in an attitude of worship, a position of humility, and do it with absolute gratitude. That's why I love Taldar. It's my favorite Hebrew words of praise. Giving thanks in advance for what God is going to do. Because this is the God we serve. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. How do I come back to faith? Through his word. So I encourage you guys, as you spend time in his word, trust God for something that not a human on this planet can give you, but God. And then only God can get the glory. Amen.